Okay, let's go over the notation for iterated integrals. We're always talking about integrating over a rectangle. And for a rectangle, we need to say, what are the starting and ending values of x? And what are the starting and ending values of y? And we'll call the starting and ending values of x a and b. And we'll call the starting and ending values of y c and d. So you'll sometimes see things written like this. We have the integral from a to b of the integral from c to d of f of x, y, dy, dx. Now there's meaning to our writing y first, because whenever you see a double integral like this, or an iterated integral like this, you should imagine parentheses in there. So this dy says the first integral, the inner integral, is over y. So the starting value for y is c, and the ending value of y is d. Well, that's just what we had in our picture. The bottom of the rectangle is at C, the top of the rectangle is at D. So the limits for Y are the bottom and the top. And then when you're done integrating over Y, then you take the result. The result will be a function of X, and we'll integrate that as X goes from A to B. Now, usually people don't explicitly write out x equals a to b, y equals c to d, although it probably wouldn't be a bad idea if they did. Usually they just write a to b, c to d, and you have to know that whatever this variable is refers to these limits of integration, and the outer variable refers to the outer limits of integration. Now, that's when you write it as an iterated integral where you integrate first over y and then over x. You could also write it as an iterated integral where you integrate first over x and then over y. So now the inner integral is an integral over x, and so the inner limits of integration are x values, and the outer limits of integration are y values. So suppose we had this integral. What region are we integrating over? Well, draw your parentheses and you say x goes from 1 to 3, and then y goes from 0 to 2. So this is the region that we're integrating over. If instead we had written the integral from 0 to 2 of the integral from 1 to 0 to 1 of 6x squared y dy dx, then the first integral would be over y, so y would go from 1 to 3, and the second integral would be over x, so x would go from 0 to 2, and you would have a very different region. Okay. So now let's look at a particular integral and see how we go about doing it. If we have the integral from 0 to 2 of the integral from 1 to 3 of 6x squared y dx dy, you know, the way we do this is we do the integral over x as if y is a constant. And it really is a constant because this is supposed to be giving us the contribution of a row. And in that row, y is a constant. So we know what the integral of 6x squared times a constant is. It's just 2x cubed times that constant, and we evaluate that at the x equals 1 and x equals 3. And when we plug that in, when you plug in x equals 3, you get twice 27y, so that's 54y. When you plug in x equals 1, you get twice 1y, that's 2y. So this is the integral from 0 to 2 of 52y dy. Okay, and do we know how to integrate 52y dy? Sure, that's no big deal. That just gives us 26y squared. Evaluated that at the limits of integration for y, and you get 104 minus 0, and that's 104. Now, we could have integrated over that region the other way. We could have integrated first over y and then over x. But remember, the y limits are 0 to 2. So if you swap the order of x and y, x always goes from 1 to 3, y goes from 0 to 2. So if we're going to integrate first over y, we're going to have to make the first integral from 0 to 2, and then the second integral from 1 to 3. That's no problem when you integrate with respect to y, you treat x as a constant. What's the integral of 6 times a constant times y dy? Well, 3 times that constant times y squared, evaluated at 0 and at 2. And that gives you 12x squared. How do you integrate 12x squared? That's easy. That gives you 4x cubed. Evaluate that at 0 and at 1 and at 3. Get 108 minus 4 is 104. Of course, the integral is exactly the same. The calculation was a little bit different. You can do a double integral, first integrating over x and then y, or you can do it first integrating over y and then x. Either way is legitimate. Now, that doesn't mean that either way is equally easy. There are some problems that are much easier to do in one direction than the other. So here's an example. Suppose we want to integrate the function x e to the xy over the rectangle where x goes from 1 to 3 and y goes from 0 to 2. Well, one way to do that is to integrate first over y. And this isn't bad. We integrate as y goes from 0 to 2, x e to the xy dy, and then we integrate that as x goes from 1 to 3. Now, a constant times e to the constant y dy, well, the antiderivative of that is just e to the xy. So we plug in e to the xy, plug in y equals 2 and y equals 0. When y equals 2, we get e to the 2x. When y equals 0, we get e to the 0x, in other words, 1. So we get e to the 2x minus 1. Then we integrate that from 1 to 3, and we get 1 half e to the 2x minus x, evaluated at 1 and at 3. Here's what you get when you plug in 3. Here's what you get when you plug in 1. And the total comes out 2. E to the 6 minus e squared minus 4 over 2. Or if you prefer, you could write it as e to the 6 minus e squared over 2 minus 2. Either way, it's the right answer. So what would have happened if we'd done it in the other direction? If we tried integrating first over x and then over y. Oh, it's perfectly legal. You can do whichever order you want. But you notice that in order to do the inner integral, how do you integrate x e to the x times a constant? Well, you got to integrate by parts. You got to let u equal x and du equals dx, and dv is whatever's left over, e to the xy dx, which means that v is e to the xy over y. And so you get uv evaluated at the endpoints minus the integral of v du. And you crank and crank and crank, and you get 3 e to the 3y over y minus e to the 3y over y squared minus e to the y over y plus e to the y over y squared. So then you have to integrate that over y, and it's a mess. You have this messy, improper integral. It looks like you're dividing by y as y goes to 0, that's a problem. Okay. It can be done. In fact, here is the calculation. The way to do this integral is to write everything as something over y squared. And it's an improper integral, so you take the limit as the lower, as from b to 2, and then take the limit as b approaches 0. Now, the thing that you're integrating turns out to be the derivative of e to the 3y minus e to the y over y. You can check that from the quotient rule. You get the bottom times the derivative of the top minus the top times the derivative of the bottom, all divided by the bottom squared. You plug that in at 2 and at b, and you get e to the 6 minus e squared minus e to the 3b minus e to the b over b. And then you got to take a limit. And how do you take a limit? Well, you got to dredge out L'Hopital's rule. And you take that limit, and the limit of this is 2, and you get the same answer as before. But which is easier? I strongly advise you not to get into the habit of automatically integrating first over x, and not to get into the habit of automatically integrating first over y. Sometimes it's much easier to do it one way. Sometimes it's much easier to do it the other way. You got to be good at both, and then use whichever one gives you the easier computation.